New subsidy scheme aims at reducing poverty rate. Lingering questions over education proposal targeting ethnic minorities. And more government offices targeted by protesters in Thailand.
Hello and a very good evening. The government has unveiled details of its new $3 billion subsidy scheme for low-income working families, which was announced by the chief executive during his policy address yesterday. It estimates the plan, which will also cover new migrants, will slash the overall poverty rate by over 2%. Gerardo Silva reports.
The plan aims to benefit 710,000 people from low-income working families not covered by the Comprehensive Social Security Assistance Scheme. Low-income households of two or more members, where at least one is working, will be paid according to a two-tier system based on the number of working hours and income. Under the scheme, a family with an income of 50% or below the median household income, where one member works between 144 and 208 hours a month, will be entitled to a $600 basic monthly subsidy. For a family whose applicant meets the working hour threshold, it can get a monthly allowance of between $600 and $1,000, depending on the number of hours worked. For a family with an income ranging from 50% to 60% of the median household income, the subsidy slashed in half. The working threshold is significantly lowered for single-parent households. The plan also includes a child allowance granted according to the number of children. And it covers new migrants too. That's despite a controversial judgment by the Court of Final Appeal recently, which ruled it unconstitutional to deny welfare to people who have been living here for less than 7 years.
To sustain employment amongst the poor population, we do not find it necessary to distinguish applicants on the basis of their length of residence in Hong Kong. Because you can imagine if new arrivals are coming to Hong Kong for family reunion, the best way is really to integrate them into a society as early as possible. And the best way to integrate people in a society is to enable them to work.
The income threshold for applicants will generally disregard financial assistance received through other schemes, such as the disability allowance and the old age allowance.
And to make life easier for those having to apply for social benefits from different departments, the government is considering creating a one-stop shop service whereby applicants can handle all the paperwork. Joanda Silva, TVB News.
New initiatives in the policy address to help ethnic minority students overcome their language barrier have been widely applauded, but the government is being urged to see them through properly.
It's been hailed by many as a major step forward in integrating Hong Kong's ethnic minority communities.
From 2014-15 school year onwards, we'll have the Chinese language curriculum second language learning framework at senior secondary levels. We will provide an applied learning Chinese language subject, so this can be regarded as another Chinese language qualification. In addition, we would like to develop vocational Chinese language courses.
But with less than 9 months before the new school year begins, an ethnic minority rights group is asking for more details. Unison Today praised the government for the new initiatives, but pointed out the only way of making this plan work is proper planning and support for teachers.
If you have a formal curriculum which is firmly established, if you have corresponding, coordinated teaching material as well as teacher training, as well as benchmark, as well as assessment, then the support they are given will actually allow them to achieve the purpose.
Sounds like a lot to be done, but Ng says it's not an impossible task. She called on the government to set up a Chinese as a second language centre and an independent advisory group, saying they can pull together experience and expertise from other countries.
So what is lacking is neither the money, nor the expertise, nor the experience, nor the will among some fair-minded people. It is the government's will.
Facing legislators this morning, Leung Chun-ying insisted that his administration has the will. But he also called on ethnic minority groups to take an active role.
There are certain obstacles that they face on a day-to-day basis that can be dealt with through the initiatives on the part of government and also the work of many community organizations out there. I hope members of the ethnic minority groups will be forthcoming to work with government to allow, for example, their children to learn better Chinese.
Tackling a shortage of housing has been one of the main policy goals of the Leung Chun-ying government. And there's been a positive reaction to what the chief executive pledged he would do to meet this challenge.
Amid the mad scramble for housing supply, there is land being left idle because property developers have refused to pay land premiums set by the Lands Department. At the question and answer session at LegCo this morning, the chief executive was lauded for a new pilot scheme which will allow third-party arbitrations on land premium levels.
It is important for the development industry to be forthcoming, to actually initiate the modification application process, because the government can't initiate the process for developers. And if the two sides do not cannot come eye to eye on the question of the level of premium payable, then we use arbitrators to determine that figure.
While it's hoped this will unlock more land for private housing supply, Leung's proposal to redevelop the 50-year-old Hua Fu estate for more public and subsidized housing was also well received. And people are calling for other old estates to be redeveloped too. Built in 1958, Sai Wan Estate is even older than Hua Fu. The housing department spent $130 million to refurbish it in 2006, extending its lifespan to 2021. There are about 35,000 units in estates across Hong Kong which are more than 40 years old, with no plans to redevelop them. The Long-Term Housing Strategy Steering Committee had earlier suggested redeveloping old estates with low plot ratios. Committee member Wong Kwan said it may be a last resort, but if Hua Fu Estate is a successful way of increasing housing supply, other old estates should follow suit. He warned that this would not be a speedy process, since the government would first need to arrange new housing for residents still living in the old estates.
A poll shows a drop in support for the chief executive's policy address this year compared with the one a year ago. The University of Hong Kong's public opinion program questioned about 1,000 people after Leung Chun-ying delivered his speech yesterday. The score was 54.1 points, a drop of 2.3 points from his maiden address last year. This year's speech suffered a significant drop in support, especially among respondents aged between 18 and 29. But Leung's overall approval rating did go up from 45.6 points to 48.9 points after the speech.
On to other news now, and mainland police have arrested a prominent scholar from the Uyghur community, taking away computers, cell phones and even student manuscripts. According to his wife, police in the capital raided his home yesterday, taking 6 hours to carry out their operation. Ilam Toti is arguably the most famous mainland-based critic of the Communist Party's policies in the western region of Xinjiang. He has written extensively about how Uyghurs have become second-class citizens in a country whose constitution supposedly ensures the rights of all ethnic groups. Protesters in Thailand trying to force out the government marched on revenue offices today, but their numbers appear to be dwindling, and some say the movement could be running out of steam. James Aiken with the latest.
Anti-government protesters woke up this morning waiting for the latest marching orders. In yet another speech the night before, protest leader Suthep Subban urged demonstrators to keep up the pressure on the government. I'll wait for the order from Suthep where we are going to march to topple caretaker Prime Minister Yingluck Shinawat, said this protester. Soon, a few hundred protesters were off to the government revenue offices to demand they close. But it appeared they already were. His revenue official said no one was in the offices today. In fact, many ministries and state agencies have been closed to avoid confrontation with demonstrators. Operations and services are being maintained at backup offices. Shutting down government agencies is the latest tactic by protesters as part of a renewed push to force out the government. But the number of demonstrators at camps appears to be dropping. Despite the turmoil, Yinluck stays on the job, maintaining that demands by protesters are impossible under the Constitution. She said next month's parliamentary election will go ahead as scheduled.
I think election will be the final just by the people of Thailand, the majority that people still need Pua Thai to continue the work of the government or will be other party. So I think this is the best way of the respect of the vote of the majority of the people.
Suthep has threatened to capture Yinluck and other members of the caretaker cabinet to force them to step down. But the protest leader, who has an outstanding arrest warrant on him, may soon find himself in police custody. Thailand's deputy premier has announced that police intend to take him in. Meanwhile, a state anti-corruption panel is due to give a ruling on a money-guzzling farm subsidy program. It's another drain on the Thai economy that is also seeing disruptions to manufacturing, exports, consumption, and tourism. The ruling could give new ammunition and new energy to opponents of the government. James Aiken, TVB News.
And still to come in the news tonight. Prostitution ring in Yulong uses vacant shops at a mall. Protests against abuse of Indonesian domestic helper. And referendum in Egypt points to strong support for new constitution.